sit, stay. This is the right spot. Because naturally, the local boys of summer spend some dog days of summer at Five County Stadium. And yeah, the occasional bark in the park surrounds plenty of thrill on the field. This addition also goes to the birds as we include some wings and some players. What else is up with these Mudcats? Depends on who else is out and about.
Everybody clap your hands.
No need to hold the applause for Tristan Lutz, who receives our Catch of the Month honor. Even his fellow outfielder appreciated this wild grab in the gap. Worth one more watch for everyone.
Everybody clap your hands.
At the plate June 27th, Lutz drew more praise for beginning this two-out, none-on rally. Mario Feliciano walked. Peyton Henry was beamed, allowing Rob Henry to deliver a two RBI single en route to a victory whirl. Next, a fifth-year minors veteran gets his crack at explaining how he has established such a devoted Eastern Wake following. Mainly, it concerns the man with the memorable mane just being a really, really cool cat.
Do you think you haven't moved up? Because I'm looking at your numbers. You're a 277 career minors hitter. You steal 87% of your bases. Your last 700 defensive chances, you've got 10 errors. You average an error every 70 chances. What do you think it is? I mean, what do you think it is?
I don't know. Cards haven't played. Hey, it's opportunity, I guess.
I got you.
You know what I mean? It's just, it is what it is. Just go out here and grind till you get it.
What's the one common, no matter where you end up, what's the one thing about minor league baseball that people may not know? That it's just, no matter where you go, it's the same.
Something that's the same, I'd say baseball is baseball, man. Whatever level, low A, high A, double A, it's all the same. It gets a little more fine-tuned the higher you get up, but mm-hmm. I mean, see it, catch it, hit it, throw it, you know, it's all,
it's all simplicity.
It's all baseball, yeah, it's as simple as you want to make it.
Which again brings me back to my original question, because you seem to do all the basics so well. above average, in fact, because I read somewhere that when you were junior in high school, you were batting eighth in your order.
Yeah.
And you were like a scrawny 160 pounder. What changed? What happened? Spurt? Or just you just said, hey, I'm kicking in?
I was kind of a late bloomer. I had a couple seniors or something that were ahead of me that just grew way faster than everybody else. I mean, that's always been my way of being able to stay on the field is I have to be able to do the little things well. You know, I'm a speed guy, make a lot of contact, steal some bases to make up for that lack of power. You know, they hit it to the fence, hit a double, I'd have to go to second, walk, you know, then steal second. That's my way of hitting a double or a triple. So, I mean, any way I can do to keep up with everyone else. And now I'm fortunate enough to be strong enough to where I can, you know, kind of hit the ball and steal some bases. So we're trying to piece it all together. And, you know, I'm just going to do my part every single day to be a better baseball player and hopefully help the Brewers win in the big league level. That's why we're all here. We're all here to develop and fine-tune our skills, and hopefully they can use me as an asset. I was always pretty tall. Yeah, I was kind of a beanpole. I could probably dunk a basketball since seventh grade.
Right.
So, I mean,
I heard you had a promising basketball career.
Yeah.
Was there some interest from the colleges or when you left?
I had some smaller schools when I played AAU and travel ball for like freshman year, sophomore year. But I didn't play for my school because I didn't want to interfere with baseball.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I didn't. I just played travel ball. I played travel basketball all the way through junior year of high school, but I didn't play for the actual school.
So you will manage to elude the football team, because I know they would love to have you as a wideout.
100%.
And I know your basketball team, the basketball coach was trying to tackle you, won't he?
Yeah, every day when I walked in the door. This is the ultimate competition in my perspective. Like basketball, football, if you want to do better, you can kind of just try harder or just be a little more athletic. Like out here, you really have to you have to fine tune like how your mind works to like allow your body to do what it naturally does. Whenever you get in your own head, you're just messing yourself up. Football, if you get angry, you just go hit somebody harder and, you know,
right.
Do whatever you do. But this is the ultimate way to compete against someone. Like hitting is the greatest thing in the world, and I love it.
How do you stay in tune? How do you keep yourself like I am playing every day? Because you never know when you are going to be called on.
Yeah, that's kind of one of the things you just learn how to do. Obviously, it's a struggle for me because I've never really done it, but I mean, that's how it's going to be when you get called up to the big leagues in the beginning. So I just take it all as practice for whenever I get to be wherever I am. So
now, would you consider yourself like a throwback? Because I'm a lot older than you. When I was coming up, we had Ricky Henderson, and I had a bunch of people who stole bases. The art of the stolen base in baseball seems to be one of those things that seems to be like Jurassic Park. It seems to be a fossil. Are you a throwback kind of guy? Because, I mean, you're so successful on the bats.
Yeah, I could say that. I mean, it's also one of those things that the media and stuff doesn't always really see. But people on the field, especially later in games, will definitely always appreciate that art. Like, see the Kansas City Royals a couple years ago. That's how they won the World Series.
Right.
And that Gerard Dyson and, you know, Billy Hamilton and guys like that. You know what I mean? Like, it's just keep doing what you do. That's all you can do out here.
What you did in 2017 is pretty remarkable. 70 steals. What do you like to see in a pitcher that says, I'm going to get this guy?
To me, to simplify things, like, if your lead's big enough, if I can stand closer to second base, I'm pretty much running. I can't outrun a baseball, but I can stand closer to second base. So that's kind of my take on stolen bases. If there's a guy on the mound and I can get back to first base without having to dive or slide, I know I can extend my lead, and there's almost no shot he's going to throw me out of second.
I got you.
As you get older, you kind of figure out, like, there's certain times and places where you can pick your spot a little bit better. You don't necessarily have to steal a base just to steal one to, you know what I'm saying? Like, And obviously, you said my reputation speaks for itself. So now as I get a little older and, you know, I've seen some guys and they know who I am, like, they're 1-0s to the plate and super quick, and there's no need for me to run, like, and just get thrown out. Mm-hmm. As you said, like, I pride myself on being successful more than how many I steal. I want to have the ability to take it whenever I need to take it,
right,
versus just running like a maniac out there. So just have to know when to pick your spots. Never ran the 40. I never really got clocked and ran the 40 because I always kind of dodged football.
But, right.
Yeah, I'd imagine I'd be around a 4.5, 4.4.
And with the length of your legs, you get from one base to the other in a few less strides than anybody else.
That's about right, yeah.
Right. Characterize yourself as a hitter, because like I said, you've had success at every level.
I can swing the bat a little bit. For me, it's more like, I'm sure like all tall, lanky guys that play baseball kind of struggle with this. It's kind of figuring out how to sequence your body. So whenever my body's sequenced up and I'm moving the right way, I'm doing the things that I'm supposed to do the right way, I feel like I can compete against any pitcher that you put out on the mound. And then sometimes I run into trouble when I'm like fighting myself. that's normally when I have my struggles, and that's all part of baseball. That's why I'm here, trying to figure out like the most consistent way that I can go out there and be the best version of myself.
Oh, you had been drafted out of high school, mm-hmm. and said, nah, I'm gonna go on to Spartanburg, and it turned out to be a very, very smart decision, mm-hmm. because your draft, you went way up in draft. I think yeah. from 28 to
fourth.
To fourth, yeah. Exactly. So it was the right decision. What spurred the decision at the time?
Just I wanted to grow and develop and see what I could become. Like, I saw a couple of my buddies, and you kind of have to, whenever you get into this kind of business or pro ball like this, man, I mean, it's pretty cutthroat, man. You don't want to leave a bad taste in someone's mouth. And I wasn't quite sure that I was ready to perform at the level that I needed to. So instead of chancing it, I decided to go get a little stronger, see a little bit better pitching, and kind of adapt and adjust my way in until I was ready to compete.
And again, a brilliant decision, yeah, because it paid off. I mean, it paid off for you.
Thank you.
Now, close to 500 minor games, 1,800 at bats. Have you seen it all? Or can you see it all?
I don't even think you can, but you prepare yourself as best as possible. And I feel like I've gotten a little taste of a little bit of everything. So I mean, it's all about how you prepare now. And I realize like you have to be able to prepare for what you're going to see on the mound, whether that's like the video in the locker room or like the night before watching some film on the guy and knowing what his ball does when you get in there. Just that little, any little advantage you can get, because how hard hitting is, how good defenses get as you move up, like whatever slight advantage you can take, you got to make the most of it.
Grand Junction Rockies, the Asheville Tourists, where you had the 70 steals, Modesto Nuts, Lancaster Jet Hawks, Hartford Yard Goats, and now the Carolina Mudcats. Well, is there any place that you've been that just blew your mind and said, okay, now this is a weird spot?
A weird spot? Yeah. Modesto was the weirdest ballpark that I played in, man. I went through some struggles, some dog days.
How so?
Whenever there's a mound that feels like it's like higher up than like other mounds, it kind of just messes with me. It messes my mind. The field was a graveyard, man. I went through some grind. Well hit balls didn't fall, man. I went through it in Modesto for a little bit, but grinded through it with my teammates, and it turned out to be a great season. We had a great time.
Cool.
That ballparks like this definitely play to my advantage as a defender, just because I can take away some of those doubles and triples that other guys hit that I guess other people wouldn't normally have time to get to, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But on the flip side, a lot of the balls I hit out there are definitely getting caught as well. So I mean, kind of works both ways.
Exactly. But do you like it here in Carolina? Has everybody been welcoming to you?
Oh, for sure. This is a great organization. I'm super blessed and thankful to be a part of it, man. Everyone in the clubhouse, like coaching staff, best of the best, man. Great people here.
Hey, for Zeblin and everybody around here, we are mighty lucky to have you, and we just hope for the best for you.
Thank you, man.
Let's turn the camera on. Pull the sky. Mudcats,
if they don't win, it's a well, let me hear ya, cause it's one,
two, three,
four,
the
all ball
game.
We're inside the game. Muddy always makes appearances on the party circuit.
Yep.
Here at an East Wake High graduation celebration, he makes himself comfortable entertaining the touchy fishy inhabitants.
One, two, three.
Awesome. Thank y'all so much. Yeah. Oh! Maybe, just maybe, these are the sweetest seats in the house. Back among the grass, it does not always go Carolina's way. Its own home can be burglarized by great rival acts. Which brings us to the concluding close call collection. Lutz was swiped during his drive by the first baseman.
Hey,
And this Devin Hairston tag after a Feliciano throw was deemed a tap too late. But not so if Hairston made the touch. First baseman Ryan Aguilar lobbed a pitcher Phil Bickford for a near double play on a foul out. Then Zach Clark gunned to Peyton Henry. Getting this runner attempting to advance after a flyout. Hairston's blurringly quick backhand punched out this possible hit in the hole. Pat McInerney also denied an infield single with some sizzle. Hairston, however, found his path and the plate blocked on the scoring scamper. Yet again, Hairston worked the hairpin turn on this twin keel for Carolina's benefit. Under the judge's ruling, this dead heat did not favor the offensive feat. Rather than rally time, it's really time to bid so long. Just not for very long. Soon, we will pick off in July, right where we left off in June. The only hassle is waiting until then.